Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, let's get started. Good morning, everyone. It's my pleasure to introduce Qi Tian. She is an associate professor at the University of Texas in San Antonio. 3 years ago, he spent 1 year sabbatical at MSR Asia, and he has been a world expert in multimedia information retrieval. He has done a lot of research from row-level feature extraction to the indexing retrieval. So today, he will talk about some new research entitled Spatial Coding for Large-Scale Partial Duplicate Image Retrieval. So,
thanks, Zhiyu, for a nice introduction. So this is our recent, actually last year's work for this large-scale partial duplicate image retrieval. And so during my talk, if you have any questions, just feel free to interrupt me anytime. So first, this is a joint work with my co-supervised student, Wen Gangzhou. And now Wen Gang is here. He's my current postdoc at UTSA, and also collaborate with Professor Hou Qiangli from USTC China, and Lucy Liu from Texas State University. So here's our talk outline. The first introduction to the problem, then I talk about the motivation for geometrical verification for this partial duplicate image retrieval. Then I propose this spatial coding scheme and how to construct this spatial coding map. We also have four enhancements beyond this spatial coding map, and finally show the experiments and show two demos. One is an online demo using my laptop. Another is this video demo, okay, for 10 million image database. So what's the problem? So our goal is to search images with partial duplicate patches in this large scale this image databases. So what are the partial duplicate images? So in our definition, so these partial duplicate images are defined by editing the original images with some changes, for example, in scale, cropping, or partial occlusion. Okay. There is, a website called TinEye, which does a very similar thing to our work. And it claimed it has indexed over 1.1 billion images. So some of the results are compared to examples compared to their cases. We have to say partial duplicate image retrieval is different from general image-based object retrieval or general object recognition, because the latter is more challenging and has more variations due to three-point viewpoint change, object class variability. So partial duplicate image retrieval is more mature. In this slide, we list some of the potential applications. So first, of course, for dedupe to save storage space, and for copyright violation detection. And maybe it can be used on some mobile devices to search for landmark, artwork, logo, and some like product search. And this is, we list this application because it depends on the feature we used for this work. We use SIFT-based features. So that works better on the rigid object than the non-rigid object.
Is there any, I was wondering if there's any quantitative
Duplication?
If the image is exact same as the image, of course that duplicate. But if like if I warp it, that's still
you
consider that duplicate. I mean, there must be some kind of criteria to determine whether it's duplicate or not.
So you will see some examples in my slides later. And so for partial duplicate images, we assume local patch, spatial patch are similar.
Similar, like exactly same.
Maybe there's some due to various like transformation. So some can be a fine transformation.
Okay.
Okay. Some can be the change like you know viewpoint, something like that.
Okay.
So this slide shows a general pipeline for image retrieval. So first you have you collect large scale image database. The next step is you perform feature extraction. So in the early days, we extract global features like color, texture, shape. But in the last 10 years, local features become more popular. So this lists some of the local features: safety feature, server feature, or MCR based feature. And the second step is you have a lot of this local feature extracted from image database. So in average, one image could be extracted several hundreds to a few thousands local features. So therefore, the next step is to build a descriptive visual code book. In the last 2 years, we also have two papers. One is a build descriptive view word and descriptive view phrase. And another work is a contextual visual vocabulary construction. So published in ACM Multimedia 2009 and 2010. And third step is how do you index, how to build an efficient indexing structure. So for this work, we use the inverted file, index file. And finally, okay, let's do the image retrieval. So that's the general few key steps for the image retrieval. Okay, let's briefly talk about each step. So for the local features, we list here some of the desired properties for local features. For example, it should have a high repeatability. So therefore, make them environment to innovation, rotation, or scale change. And it should be unique. So each feature has a distinctive description. And for example, has to be compact and efficient to compute. And also preserve some locality property. For example, any occupies a relatively small patch of image, makes them robust to occlusion or clutter, the background. To extract local features, there are two steps. The first step is a local feature detection, or called interest point detector. And second step is a interest point descriptor. Okay. Here at least a few, this well-known or popular used interest point detector, says Harris, and DOG-based, different Gaussian, Harris Fan, Hessian Fan, and MCR. And these are some popular interest point descriptor. The most well-known is SIFT, or PC SIFT, okay, or some SIFT context-based. So in this work, since we used SIFT descriptor as our local features, so this slide gives a brief introduction. I know many of you may already been very familiar with this context. So for SIFT detector, either a difference of Gaussian-based or MCR-based. So to describe this SIFT, okay, first, okay, centered at this interest point location, we get a 16 by 16 patch. Then for each pixel in this 16 by 16 patch, we compute its orientation. Then we find the dominant orientation for all the pixels in this local patch. The next step is we rotate this local patch to the dominant orientation found in this local patch. Then we further cut this 16 by 16 patch into 4 by 4, these patches. So then for each patch, use 8 bin, this histogram, to do the orientation here histogram. So therefore, for each patch, it's 8 dimension. So we have a 14 by 14, 16. 16 times 8 is 128 dimension. So for one local feature. The second step is, as I said, one image, they could result in hundreds of, or even a few thousands of local features. And each feature is a high dimensional this vector, 128 dimension. Now consider large scale database, for example, millions of images or even billions of images. So it's a very, very large space of these local features. So next step, people usually perform feature clustering, k-means, or use hierarchical k-means, or other clustering algorithms like affinity propagation. and use these class centers, okay, and the visual it's code words, so-called visual word, okay. And so this is construction of visual code book. So third step is once visual code book is constructed, we need to this to the feature assignment, feature quantization, which means map a high-dimensional local feature vector to a visual word in a code book. And usually, this nearest labor assignment is used for this purpose. And next, step three is build an inverted indexing file. So this is a list of the visual code words in a visual code book. And so for image in a database, first we extract local features. Then through this feature quantization, map its local feature to one of the visual word in this list. Then link this image to this visual word. For example, this image has two local features, so linked to mapped to these two visual words. So you link these two images along this list. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, good question. So we expect it has more semantic meaning. But from what we have got, it's still kind of low-level description. So many work or in the past has been developed to how to model like a semantic meaning, how to model the spatial context in a visual code book. So a lot of literature on this direction. So it cannot be really compared to the text domain, like keywords. Okay, it's just not that high level. So then for the second image, okay, we do the same thing and link the image to the features, to the mapped visual words it contains. Okay. So after we done for the all the images in the database, okay, so we built this this so-called inverted index file structure. So what can we do with this inverted index file? Simply, we can use it to do the retrieval. For example, okay, given a query image, okay, extract local features, then map to the visual words, and we simply can vote each image, okay, containing this visual word. Okay. This is like a voting by term frequency, and we can return images with the votes. Okay, this can to achieve the image retrieval. So visual word concept was proposed in Video Google ICCV 2003. And there's another popular work by David List, so-called Construct a Visual Vocabulary Tree in CVPR 2006. And after that, and a lot of work in this direction. And I just did a few related. So how to construct higher order visual word, okay, how to construct a collocating pattern, say bundled features by Sun Jie from MSIA. I'll talk about it later in the slides. And how to build visual synsets, okay, and our work, how to construct descriptive visual words, descriptive visual phrase, and how to build a contextual visual vocabulary. Okay, this the next slide, I'm talk about the motivation.
Clustering of the image and visual words.
You mean how to construct the visual code?
Because you create the visual word and you associate image with the visual word. But I think essentially this is a bi-clustering problem. One dimension is the number of the images. Another dimension is the features, which is the visual words. Have you think about use the bi-clustering trying to do something like this, rather than just clustering over the features?
Mm. We haven't tried that. So nowadays, because of simplicity or easiness, so k-means, especially hierarchical k-means, are adopted to generate these so-called visual words for the images. Okay. And certainly there can be different ways to generate like a visual code book. So even if like in our work, okay, instead of considering each single local feature, we consider features in pairs and consider the co-occurrence context, spatial context, to build this visual word pair and the basic description element. So I just feel like maybe there are lots of ways to do that. So this is we talk about why this geometric verification is important in this scenario, partial duplicate image retrieval. So our contribution for this work lies here. Okay. So after this three steps, we construct a spatial coding map and to do the spatial verification. And spatial verification are two ways. One is a local spatial verification and global verification. And our method is a global spatial or geometric verification in this scenario. Okay. And finally perform the image retrieval. So the goal is originally, when two images are matched to each other, there are a lot of the forced matched sieved features. Okay. Our contribution is to efficiently remove forced matched sieved features. Of course, this force match is in terms of the geometrical consistency. Okay, we preserve the sieved matched features by checking their geometrical consistency. Okay.
So this module is done at the indexing stage or in the retrieval stage?
Retrieval stage. So in the indexing stage, I will talk about later in your slides. We're going to save some information for the matched features. So for example, image ID, this feature comes from which image. Second is for each sieved feature, what's its scale, like one value, one number, what's orientation, and what's its location, so XY location in the image. So that's the information we store in the indexing stage. And during the retrieval stage, we're going to use this information to build a spatial coding map online and do the spatial verification. So this is an example. Okay, this shows the sieved point matches between these two relevant, we call the partial duplicate images. And you can see this matches, okay, consists of two parts. We call the true matches and the false matches. And false matches mainly because they're geometrically inconsistent. For example, some hair point on here match to here. Okay, so our goal is to design a filtering method to preserve these true matches and filter these false matched features. Okay. So what caused this problem? Okay, there are a few factors. So first, the local features they do not preserve enough spatial information, and also they are not stable due to affine transformation, sometimes corrupted by noises. In a feature quantization, because it's from high-dimensional feature vector to a single ID, so it is introduced a large quantization error. And in this very long bank of visual words model, it's orderless, no spatial information. And in the indexing, in the past, the scale and orientation information for the local features are not used. And we found orientation and scale of the local features are very important for partial duplicate image retrieval, and we use it in our work. From the raw images. And also, I have to point out is when we download image by image from the internet, we reduce image size to 400 by 400. So in average, per image, there are about 300 local features.
So I was wondering, have you tried to explore directly from the compressed image because the compression
really
give you some kind of feature,
even
maybe for different scales?
Mm-hmm. So far, we haven't. we can discuss later. Because we haven't done anything for the compressed in the compressed domain. So we use raw features from this image from Okay. So it's a geometric verification. The goal is to first to be effective to remove these false math features. Again, false is means they are geometric inconsistent. Okay. And secondly, it has to be fast, efficient in implementation. Considering like if you do retrieval over millions of images, 10 billion images, 100 million images, has to be real-time response. Okay. So it has to be really fast. So there's two verification. One is local verification. So there's two of the representative work. One is a bounded feature from CPR, from MSI in CPR 2009, and local nearest neighbor approach. So two global verification, well-known is this RASANC, and our this spatial coding map. So this work is based on a previous publication on AC Multimedia 2010, plus some extensions. So for the local geometrical verification, so this is video Google ICC 2003. So the idea is simple. So considering there are two points matched from in image one, image two, A matched to B. In order to accept the true matches, we also consider each the neighborhood of each feature. Okay, if the labels are also mapped to the same visual world, we consider these pairs has local region support. If no neighborhood matched to each other, becomes no region support, and we're going to reject them. That's the idea. However, this is a drawback. Is this approach is kind of sensitive to the cluttered background. Okay. So second approach is a bounded feature. So in this approach, instead of consider each individual feature alone, you consider features in groups. The group they mean from MSER region, and so this shows two bundled these features. So this bundle has four local features. This has five. So they are matched. Four of them are matched to the same visual words. Okay. So this is another example. There are two bundles. Also, they have four features mapped to the same visual word. So next step is they use the spatial consistent for the bundled feature. This information is used to weight the visual words. So besides this traditional, okay, this TF IDF weighting for each visual word, he add this item M, okay, and this spatial consistency also consists two parts. The first part is how many of the shared visual words between these two bundles. So for example, both of these two cases they share same four visual words. But the second part is the spatial consistency between these two. So in the first example, they check the spatial consistency in two directions. One is x direction, horizontal. One is vertical, y direction. For example, in the x horizontal direction, so in increasing order is okay, circle, this triangle, cross, and this square, okay, for this bundle. And also for second bundle, in the increasing order in the x direction, it's also circle, this triangle, this cross, and square, which means the order of these bundled features in the x direction is consistent. Okay. Also, this is consistent in the y direction. Okay. But for the second case, in the x direction, okay. So this is a circle, this a triangle, cross, and this one, but it got the incorrect matching order. So therefore, the match order is false on the first one and third one. So you consider you have a 2 degree of inconsistent. Okay. And so they showed good performance for partial duplicate image this detection in over 1 million database. However, this method has a drawback. So it's going to be infeasible if this bundle is rotated, okay, because the XY, this order will be changed. So for global verification, okay, the most well-known is this RASANC algorithm. So RASANC stands for random sample consensus. It's an iterative procedure. So iterative remove outliers by inner classification. Our inner are defined as true matched features. Outlier is false matched features. So he started with randomly sample some features, consider them as inners, and estimate a fine transformation model based on these matched features. then use this model to test against all the other features in the image. Then do then classify them as inline and outliers. And then based on the increased inline data set, do the resampling again and estimate the model again and so on. And the drawback of this one is computational expensive, therefore it's not scalable. Usually in image retrieval, when we have initial retrieval image list, it takes the top 300 or top 500 to do the RESAC check. Okay. So basically, it only re-ranks the images within the top 300 images or it's 500 images. Okay. So in our case, we basically check all the images returned by this inverted file indexing. So okay, next is how to construct a spatial coding map. The key idea is we're going to construct a spatial coding map which can record relative spatial positions between matched features. In the first work of this direction, we construct two maps. One is called X map, and the second is Y map to record the relative spatial position in the X and the Y direction. And for example, okay, this image has four matched features. Okay. Now we use, in this X map, we use the reference point as I. We consider the relative position J respect to I. If J is right to I, we record as zero. Otherwise, record as one. Okay. And similarly, so if we consider reference point I, if J is above I, record as zero, otherwise record as one. So let me show you this this toy example. So first, we start with reference point one, okay? Because two and three are right to one. So for the first point one, the first line, okay, and the two and three position, they're recorded as zero, okay? The rest are recorded as one, okay? And then consider the Y map, okay, for the point one. Because all the points are below it, including itself, so it's recorded as all ones in the Y map. Okay. So this is done for the X map and Y map for the first feature. Then we move to the second feature. For reference two, reference point two, since three is on the right side of two, so it's zero in the X map. Okay. And in the Y direction, since point one is above point two, okay, so at the position one, it's recorded as zero, the rest are ones. So we're done for the second one. So we just continue until we finish this coding for all the this, matched features in the image. Okay. We construct this so-called this X map and Y map for each image. Okay. Okay, this is for the last one. So what can we do with this, this X map and Y map? So this illustrates a very simple example. So this is a current image. This is a matched image in a database. As you can see, there are five pairs of matched features. It either can be verified. Four of them are geometrically consistent, except 0.5. Okay. And these are the X map and the Y map of the current image. It's X map and the Y map of the matched images. Since the first four are geometrically consistent, so as you can see, they have a same X map and Y map. Okay, X map and Y map. So if we take the exclusive OR operation between these two maps, and it will be all zero, okay, for on these locations, and be ones when there is the inconsistency. So when we take the summation for each row, we get the overall inconsistent degree for each feature. It can easily can be identified no matter in X direction or Y direction. 0.5 has the largest inconsistent degree. So we can identify the largest one and remove that feature, remove that column and a row, and continue this checking process for the rest of features until this inconsistent degree to be zero. Okay. So this is a very strict condition. Okay, but in the previous case, It's a very simple one. Each quadrant has any one part. Now consider each quadrant. Now it's uniform divided into two parts because a point located in this lost west corner is still different not from this located here. Okay, so we first divide it into two parts. Now this can be considered as a combination of two divisions. So the first one and the second one. We can construct XY map for the first one, but how to construct XY map for the second one? Because it's not like a horizontal vertical position. Now we can rotate 45 degrees counterclockwise. This is the rotated features. Okay. Now we can construct X map and Y map for this one. Okay. Now, so in general case, if we divided each quadrant uniform into R parts, so we have this layout can be considered the combination of the R different division. And if we rotate each division by different angle, okay, because it's rotated this position, and we can construct X map, Y map for each of them. So put them together, we have a generalized X map and Y map. Okay. Then with this generalized X map, Y map, we can do spatial verification. So here, Q is the current image. This is M is a matched image. Okay. IJ are the local features index. Okay. From 1 to N. K is the R parts divided by how many parts from 0 to R minus 1. N is the total number of matched features. So for each, again, we take the exclusive all. If they are consistent, they'll be same. If they're inconsistent, it will be 1. Finally, sum up for the inconsistent degree for each feature in the x direction and y direction, and we identify the maximum, okay, either in x map or y map. Identify, remove it, and reiterate okay, until this gets zero. This shows some special verification example. Okay. This is the original shift match before verification. This is identified false matches. Okay, this identified being filtered by our spatial this coding verification. And this is remaining, okay, which means they passed the spatial verification, this shift matches. This shows shift matches okay, for two irrelevant images. One is a Chinese document, one is an English document. Yeah. And you can see that like tens of the shift matches on them. This is identified false matches. Okay. And still, okay, you will see there are three pairs pass the spatial verification. And at least one pair will pass the verification. Because when any one pair left, it cannot do the verification. There's no relative position information. Okay. So we still can, we filter most of the false matches. Okay.
I have a question. Your idea of introducing non-taxilinear orientation is to solve the orientation problem, right? When the credit image and the original image are rotated in a certain way.
Oh, here.
But here you are not doing that actually. You are just matching, with the same key. Key is index for the rotation. You see what I mean? If you go back.
Right now we haven't deal with the rotation invariance. Okay. So we haven't talked about this. Okay. It's a later slide. So okay, this is our indexing structure. So again, this is a list of visual words. This is matched features. Okay, for each matched features, we store this four this information. First image ID. Right now, we use 4 bytes. Roughly, can index up to 1 billion images ID. Okay, and the feature orientation. Orientation one byte. Scale, and XY location using 1 byte each. So in total, we have 8 bytes for each indexed feature. And now we reduce all the images in 400 by 400 okay, for this demo. In average, there are 300 features per image. So therefore, one image index size is about 2.4 kilobytes. And then for 1 million image index, probably 2.4 4 gigabytes. That's the demo I'm going to show. And time meaning image index 24 gigabytes. That's why I cannot show it on my laptop. I have a video. Of course, this is a very rough estimation, not optimized. We can maybe further reduce the its storage for each index feature. So beyond the spatial encoding, we have considered four of these enhancements. The first one is how to handle rotation invariance and how to further recover some false negative matched features. So even for the false features, two parts, one is a false negative and false positive. Can we have a way to re-estimate the model to recover some false negative and how to do core expansion and byte-space quantization. So in a traditional, this visual vocabulary trip done by David List, and this clustering is done is in a sieved space, which means in a, this description space, this descriptor space, 128. Then we further use the, this orientation information to filter the some of the to do this quantization. Okay. So this slide, actually, I have them hided. So when we finish the talk, I can come back to talk about some of the details of this. Okay. Now, the experiments. So we first construct one mini image database, download it from the web, then construct three smaller data sets, 50K, 200K, 500K, by random sampling them. And ground truth data set, obtain 1,100 partial duplicate web images of 23 groups and use 100 of them to do the as a representative query. Okay. We compare to three algorithms. So the baseline is David List CPR 2006 paper. This is a well-cited paper. Okay. This is using visual vocabulary tree. And second one is JGO ECC 2008 Hamming embedding plus the weekly geometric constraint. And there's a full geometrical verification using RANSAC. For performance evaluation, using first one is a mean average precision, and the second one is a time cost per query. And we didn't consider like memory cost in this work. Okay. The first experiment using this this 16 GB memory and 2.0 gigahertz CPU. So before there's still a few parameters to tune. The first one is okay, codebook size. Okay, for in the David List's paper, when they index 1 million images, they found roughly is around 1 million size of visual codebook. So we got the similar, okay, like observation. The second thing is a quadrant division factor. Each quadrant is divided into how many parts? Okay, for our case R. And last one is a orientation quantization size. And so this is a considered trade-off between this precision and cost, time cost. So this is orientation quantization size from 0 to 20, which means for a circle, 360 degree, how many further you cut, like quantize into orientation space. And we found this is a mean average precision. So we found, okay, when quantization size is 11, it achieves the best performance in terms of the precision and time cost. Okay.
Just data set dependent, I suppose.
Because we tested on like over a million image data set. So that's the result from that one. Okay.
So when you say orientation quantization, you are talking about the 360 degrees quantization, or
let me give a basic idea. So when two features match to each other. Uh-huh. They may match based on 128 descriptor, but their orientation might be totally different. So each feature has a dominant orientation. So we only consider like in a certain angle. Okay, within a certain angle, we consider their orientation consistent as well. We found that this information actually is quite useful for partial duplicate image search.
That orientation quantization is in the sieved, not in your spatial coding. Because spatial coding has
yes.
quantization.
Yes, it is in a sieved.
Sieved match.
Sieved match, okay.
That's always interesting issue where, I mean, originally they do they use principal direction, right? That means it has benefited to be sort of orientation independent. right? So rotation dependent. Rotation invariant. So, uh-huh. Yeah, feature. Mm-hmm. But actually, but at the backside, the downside is that actually causes some mismatches, I guess. Mm-hmm. That's why you actually now you sort of don't do that anymore. Sort of you say you have two SIP scripts they match only when the orientation is not, principal orientation is not. It's not too far away from
each other. Yeah, the orientation actually has to be within some
degree.
Yeah, degree.
Yeah.
And which means if this is a quantization size 11, means they are within like almost 30 degrees. And also the second is video codebook size. And we construct a different video codebook size from 12K, 130K, 250K, and 500K. And so this observation is different from what observed in David Lister's paper. Because in his work, he found when you increase the codebook size, the performance gets better, then it gets accentuated. Okay. In our case, it's different. Okay. So you can see here, when we have a smaller codebook, we get a better performance. Why is that? Because when in the feature space, when you have a smaller codebook, which means each bucket is bigger. So there are more features fall into each bucket, which means we may get a lot of the false matched features. Right? And but our algorithm can very efficiently to remove them. Okay.
So what happens when you increase codebook?
When you increase the codebook, contains much fewer points.
That means you don't have as many mismatches.
So, you do not have mismatches.
Okay.
So we found the problem for everyone. If you at the beginning, if you do not detect so much match feature, it doesn't work well. So if you have lots of features, even if a lot of false matches, we can remove them. Okay. So therefore, we found a trade-off. So for 1 million image database, 130K is a good trade-off between precision and this time cost. The last one is this quadrant division factor. So again, I guess this is on the current data set. Okay. Now we found a quadrant factor is R equals to 3, which means for each quadrant, it divided into 3 parts. Okay, we found the best performance so far. Okay, this is a summary. Okay. I say the codebook size is from 1 million image database. Okay, if you have a 100 million image database, I thought it would be assumed this will be increased. So this is a performance comparison on different size of image databases, 50K, 200K, 500K, and 1 million. And we compare with, this is the baseline, David Foster, David Lister paper. This is Hamming embedding. This is a RESAC, fully ranking method. This is a spatial coding algorithm. And this is a spatial coding plus query expansion. On a 1 million data, 1 million data set, the performance precision compared to baseline is 0.48 to 0.73, so nearly like 52 improvement in precision. And comparing to using a full geometric verification RESAC, it's improvement from 0.61 to 0.73, so roughly 20%. And if we consider query expansion above the spatial coding, it's further improved. From 0.73 to 0.88, roughly 20%. Yeah, and this is a precision. This is a time cost. Yeah. So this is time cost per image in this 1 million data set. Yeah. Okay, on our previous configuration. So this is a baseline. This is a spatial coding, and then you can find actually our spatial coding is faster than baseline. Okay, I will explain later. Okay, and when you introduce the query expansion, it introduce in average. Additional 0.6 second per query. And this is this Hamming embedding. This is re-rank using RESAC for the top 300 images. It's like a three seconds per each one. So comparing to baseline, okay, we have a 46 time reduction. Okay, this is some sample results. These are some of the queries. And these are the so-called partial duplicate images found in the database. I have a demo can show you this. For example, even if there is some occlusion here for the head, and this is very small, this is a Starbucks. This is Starbucks, and say like a, this English, a Chinese, and another this cafe like logo, and this within like this scale. This is a like some of the rotation like, viewpoint, and this I have some. I can show the demo. So further, we tested the scalability on 10 million database. This 10 million database downloaded from the web. Now we increased this computing server to 2.4 gigahertz and use 32 gigabytes memory. And this is some this approach, this performance. So in terms of the codebook size, and we have a smaller codebooks, we have a better performance. But smaller codebook, with you have a return longer image list. So the time cost will be higher. So therefore, trading between these two, we use this one. Consider the trade-off for the best performance for the 10 million images. I have a video demo for some of the examples. Okay, before the conclusion, let me show you the examples.
Could you provide some insights why the full geometric verification is worse than your spatial coding?
Because when you do the shift match, okay, when you check the indexing structure, you're going to return like for 1 million images, you might return let's say 10k image back. And full geometric verification, because it only takes the top 300 images to do that, not taking all the images. It's to resync is done only on the top returned images.
Top 300.
300 or 500. We actually checking all the returned images.
So
for 1 million database, it varies. So let's say in average, return 10K? 8,000 images.
So if you do the, without considering the time,
right.
If you do the full geometric,
yes.
It will be better. You agree with
that? Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Well,
okay.
One more question. So your verification should be have similar effects compared to because they both consider the order of
the big difference. Big difference. Because they only use a spatial consistency to weight the visual world.
Yeah.
Then so to generate.
But also use that to verify matching. They actually use that to verify matching. They don't use that to verify matching.
They just use it as a weight to
weight the visual world.
And it's resensitive to noise.
For the rotation.
Yeah, I understand for rotation, yeah. But I mean like the spatial order and information is the same, so you guys capture the same kind of information.
If they use the multiple quadrants, right?
Yeah, that part is different, yeah. I understand.
And that's why I asked the question, because currently you are comparing exactly the same order with multiple quadrants, so it doesn't help you in rotation cases. So you have to compare with, for example, vertical one with the slides. That's probably in the extension, but you didn't talk about it.
I want to show you a demo.
Yes.
Actually, I open with the slides.
I
we have a, so this is first work. Then we propose to handle rotation invariance.
Yeah.
We also have a demo for that. Actually, along this is just, this is the first work in this direction. So actually, we have different ways to model this geometric context now. Now this is like we take the like this way and cut in this way. Actually, we have a later so-called geometric ring coding. So instead of considering like which quadrant it is in, we consider like for example each point has a scale. Okay, then the relative position with respect to other points, whether it's inside this scale or outside the scale, and we can this is then we divided the image space into concentric rings, with like an increment as a, and a scale. Okay, then we get a different this spatial coding map. So along that we have a geometrical encoding. We also further improves with geometric coding, fan coding, and geometric square coding. And I have some additional slides. Okay, to hide it because I want to show the basic idea. Okay, then talk about if more discussing. Okay, so this is a.
Before you go forward, let me ask an implementation question.
Okay.
So I mean, you talk about the X map and the Y map.
Okay.
And I mean, different quadrants and different directions, right? When you talk about inverted index, uh-huh. you also talk about how to code those features.
Uh-huh.
Well, the X map and Y map, do you code it and store it with the image, or it's basically calculated on spot?
On spot, on the fly. So actually, I say we only use this X, Y, and scale orientation to generate the spatial coding online. So even if in average, one image has 300 features, does not mean we're going to construct 300 by 300 like map, because the max features is much less. So let's say 100, okay, 100 by 100. So this is going to be constructed online. And because it's most of the operation is binary, exclusive of all operation, so it's fast, very fast. Okay.
I have a question before you go to the demo.
Okay.
Can you please comment why rank 4 is not rank 1 on that query image?
Oh, okay. Good question. Actually, this can be easily fixed. Because, okay, let me show you how they are matched.
You have a very sharp eye.
actually,
I'm in the back.
So if you check here, let me just. Okay, it's in the back. Okay, this shows two matches, shift matches after the spatial verification, and this say they have 20 matches past the spatial verification, and for this is for first one, second one, they also have 20, same number of matches. Right now. They are displayed in by the image name, so that's why you see to be more this this one actually should be rank first. This is because we displayed by this is rank is determined by the number of the two matches between these two images.
So you have the number of matches, not the similarity between the matches.
So they have same number of the matches.
No. So the question is, I'm asking a question. So is your determined by the number of matches, not by the similarity within the matches?
Oh no, it's not by similarity, because originally they could match 100 saved matches. Now only maybe 20 passed the verification. So we use that number as our similarity measurement. So because this one we can reduce the further time cost to calculate the image similarity. Okay.
But you could have used the similarity of the match, right?
Actually, the first shift matches by is looking it's a hierarchical visual vocabulary tree. Okay. This shows top. This shows a top. Okay, 36 matches from the code. The database is here. Is 1.2 million images actually in my local disk. And the time cost, this is 125 milliseconds. I have to say this does not include the feature extraction time for each image. Okay, this any is everything above the feature extraction. Okay. And this codebook size, we use 1.39 million is a codebook size. And when we display 36, we return images with at least three matches passing the spatial verification. So if you have a lower than three, we didn't display. Okay. So this is a rank determined by the number of the true matches after verification. So as you can see, so even if they're small, they match. So if I have create another one, they match on this right side. So this red line means the correct match. Okay, this blue line means the incorrect match. Okay.
Question. Among these images, since they are all the orientation kind of similar, from the perspective point of view, in your early slides, you have a Mona Lisa, which two people are holding.
I can show you.
Yeah.
I can show you.
So I would just say how well.
Okay.
Some works on.
Yes. Because right now we found, of course, it works best on the flat image, flat structure. And if I have some like a curved feature, or if I have a large affine, for example, if you have a very large affine transformation, currently the sieve will miss the detection in the first space. So which means that we cannot get a good result even if due to the spatial verification. In order to improve that, you have to use for example, a fine sieve, and to detect first and then to perform a spatial verification. Now, but how good or how tolerant it is for those very curved features, we don't know. I have some example to show you, I can show right now. Okay. Let me say. So this is a Starbucks Lucifer logo. So it takes 47 milliseconds, returns top 50 with at least 3 matches. Let's see. So let's see some of the. So this one, right? Some like a viewpoint change. And this is in a same image. And this one, for example, even this star matched to here, and we consider it as an incorrect match because it's geometric inconsistent. And here, so even if it's in a cloud background, so we find the matches to be here. Now if I use this one to do the search, yeah. Okay.
I'm just going to throw an amusing question. We all know Starbucks, the trademark, the picture changes,
right?
So how does the older version and the new version matches?
Now we found this one. This looks like a Starbucks. Okay, but it's not actually.
But is that considered as duplicate or not duplicate?
It's very trivial, right?
Suppose you give it to copyright lawyers. Is this considered as
I don't know. I don't know whether it should be considered partial duplicate match or not. So it's it's the same. It's inside, except so even if they matched C match to C, K match to K, right? O match to O F F. So again, our method is still not semantic match. Okay, it's still low level feature match.
So something I was thinking that whenever I see a duplication sort of search, I always wonder. How do you judge what's duplicate or not duplicate? I mean, the definition is not that clear, right?
There's different, can I say this? There's different, I got some requests from different companies. Yeah. For example, I have an example demo. They say I have a document. It may contain a logo inside, but it may contain something logo, like company logo, or other, like a FedEx, or other logos, like 7-Eleven.
Right.
So, can you automatically find it? Okay.
Of course, you can find it.
No, automatically find it.
You find it from where?
So you have an image document. Yeah. So this the text plus.
You do have their own documents.
So for example, you have a scanned document. It contains a logo. Okay. But you have lots of documents. But given this document, can you scan it? Can you identify any logos or this trademarks from this one. So
but that's maybe So for the other people, you should don't retry.
Question. Do you have the SIF feature for the query image or the sample image? Do you have basically a tool show what are the SIF features extracted from that image?
Can we show the display features? Question is, I showed the matched features.
You show the matching features.
Right. The original features.
Whether you have the original 300 features.
We have just, okay, it's not displayed here. Okay. Now this shows, they give me this picture. Okay, this one. We found actually second image contains four logos. That's why when we do a spatial query expansion, we cannot take the whole image to the query expansion because you don't know which one you're looking for. So it has to be localized, right? So when we do the query expansion, we found the minimum bounding box for the matches and use any information here or some point match back to enrich the original this data set to do the query expansion. So this is the same idea used in someone before in ICCV 2007. Now if I say use this one to do the search, to do the query. I pressed the wrong button. So if I this one to do the search, okay, it takes 31 milliseconds, okay, and of course it also search for the Dunkin' Donuts, and also search for the 7-Eleven, and. What else? McDonald's here. Because McDonald's is really smooth, so we didn't get many points detected on McDonald's. Okay. Now, this match on Starbucks. Now, if I use this one to do the search, so we find more logos back. For example, we found there is an IBM here. Match the second picture. And we have a MSN. Even if like this is original picture, this is a. This I have a contains a FedEx second image. This is the box. It's more to search. Of course, return more. Return some Google. There is a Google Insight. This one I guess is still Google. What else? This one? I think this is a shell. That's a shell, okay.
Now you can do the clustering again to cluster the results based on the feature point location in your query image. Because the query image include multiple objects, and then you can do the clustering on the result, on the result,
okay,
and based on the feature point on the original image.
Okay.
Because
yeah.
Here, that's all of the features are on the right bottom corner.
No, actually, there's a lot of points, original points detected here. But in any final, for example, these two, they found the correct matches to be here and also pass the spatial verification. And now let me get to a final one more. This is an old couple. Okay, this is a top 44. So for example, you see a gym here. Why is that? Because there is a gym here. Okay, and. So this is maybe there's some rotation, but not much. So for example, this is a good example. So actually, there should a lot of match here, but because the position is moved, so we consider inconsistent. The match is on this old man and the house. So this one, this should be matched before, but now it got filtered. This is a Starbucks. So as I said, when we search for this, using this one, we do not know which one actually we are search for. Now, if you use any of them to do the search, yeah. Okay. Now we can show you the precision recall for this one. So this is a random choose one to do the search, yeah. And this will have a very high precision, almost one in the top returns. But this is less than 0.6, okay, 0.6 recall. And now, I'm not sure whether we can improve it. Like we can do adding a query expansion for it. So we take the top five images to do query expansion. Of course, the cost is time. And show this precision.
You have not clicked on
search. I haven't clicked on search, right. Okay, this means, so this for original is 47 milliseconds. This shows the additional cost, 125 milliseconds for the query expansion. And this is a precision recall. Okay, got a little bit higher, okay. For say 2.6 to point, but this precision is still very high. Due to the time, let me finally show this a few more cases on this 10 million image database. This is a video. We just directly copy the screen, and so this shows a 10 million image database. This is a time cost, not including the feature extraction, for 453 milliseconds. And this cubic size we used. So matches here. Even if it's very small here. We just show different category images for the logo, like a product, some artwork. This means actually it matched to the text. So it's, again, it's not semantic search. Okay, it's no level match. No level feature match.
So how many skills do you use in the features? What
do you mean skill?
You can match bigger and small images.
Okay. This depends on the image. Okay, like you want the image resolution.
Yeah.
If image is too small, uh-huh. we may not get enough points. Uh-huh. So that means we'll right now come back to fix the detection part. Okay.
So do you resample the query image?
This is 200 by 200. Yeah. Okay.
Because do you
summarize it to 400 by 400? So in average, like so if it's larger than 400 by 400, we resize it to 400 by 400. Yeah, it's original. Keep it original.
So you don't up
something. No, we don't up. Just because somewhere the internet image is too large. Like 2000 by 2000. And it takes, for the feature extract, takes.
So the reason you are able to match, you know, bigger image with small image is due to the SIFT feature?
Yes.
Because it provides.
Because at least it provides a lot of the false match and mixed with a good one.
So if you flip the image, you.
Good, very good question. Yes, it can be, we fix it actually.
Okay, so just flip it.
because we flip it, like the descriptor changed, but it's an easier way to fix it. Okay.
I know, but then I can do more, right? I can cut it in half.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
Swap
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
So that's still copyright violation.
but I guess. That's why it's, I also talked to Google. Also, do you care about flipping, like a mirror road?
Yeah.
And how many cases, real cases in a search, okay, the people, real user care about it. They don't care about it. So though it can be, I mean, for the search, okay, lots of people ask, can you do the flipping? Can you do the, or can you rotate like, say, random rotate any degree?
It depends on your application, right?
Yeah, it depends on the communication.
If I'm in the user, I just want to look for similar images,
right.
And that's fine. But right. If I'm like a really police, I want to look for anybody's
yeah.
violating copyright,
yeah.
then I would want to find anything I can, right? The easy ones, I really don't care
yeah.
about. Those ones are probably okay, but you really want to look for the sneaky ones.
So we have a version of this one to handle. Let me tell you a basic idea how to handle rotation environments. So there are two ways. The first one is we can pre-rotate images in 30 different angles, okay? And then we construct a spatial coding map for rotated pictures. Because we load the rotation, we can construct the coding map from the existing one. That's very easy. And then we do this check. Then any cost is more time cost, but we can handle rotation, but to a certain degree, not totally. Okay. Another way is let me show you the slides. Okay, the basic idea. I hide a lot of slides. Let me show. Okay. So another way is now when we construct like a spatial map, I construct sort of this R map. So for example, okay, this is a feature, this is a scale, this feature. Okay, considering the position of other features, whether they're inside or outside, if they are out, inside is one, outside is zero. Okay, now you can construct so-called this ridge map, but this is for one scale. Later, you consider this is one, just very roughly divides the image into inside and outside. Then we construct a ring. Then, for example, we use the, rotation, yes, rotation environment. Because when they fall on the same ring, no matter where they are, it's rotation environment. What we also found maybe I'm not sure in this drawback, because image is square. So you divide the image by ring, okay, may not cut the image best. So we cut the image by square. You see. That's here. So now we cut the image, for example, we can cut images by square. Okay, then inside square, outside square, and we can, there are a few. Let me display this. Right, this is five features. Now, later we add some change. So before we construct a spatial coding map, we rotate each feature according to its dominant orientation. For example, for feature two, its orientation is this one. So before we construct, we first rotate to this dominant angle. Then we cut instead of this ring inside outside, we construct a square. Okay, square might fit this image shape better. Okay, we don't know. Then, okay, this is because we know this dominant angle, we know the before rotation and the position after rotation. So we construct this after rotation, the relative positions. We can construct this square map. Further, this is square inside. We combined with this previous spatial coding map. So we can get a model different spatial context.
I still don't understand why you don't exploit your spatial coding, because your spatial coding has already divided the whole image into key orientations. So if I have one, that was my original thinking, when you present this key division of the spatial coding,
key is the key different
orientation, right?
Okay.
It can already deal with the rotation. So currently you are comparing one spatial map, coding map, with exactly the same orientation. So you can compare with different orientation.
But that's slow.
Maybe this is all the way to
the faster,
because only
under okay. So we have some results. Okay, show you the results. Okay, now you can, like, one is you can rotate different angles, right? But that's actually the linear cost, roughly. Right? Because
you don't need to rotate the images. Because
I know.
Map is already.
Yeah. That's what we
need to change the order of the comparison.
Yes, actually, I had this, like, that's what exactly we do here in our extension. So we had let's just use this one. I had it. So in one is you do not need to rotate images. Okay, you rotate this. This is a rotated position of the features. So you just need to construct online the feature map for this one. And this is a simple way for when this is rotated 90 degrees. Now, this is a code before and after this rotation. And the next is, now if you rotate 45 degrees, and this is a code before and after. So basically, so 2 becomes 3, 3 becomes 4, 4 becomes 5. This is rotation.
I think you didn't understand what happened. Okay, that's fine. We can talk this later, yeah.
Okay.
Because you have already, okay, if you go back to your spatial coding image.
This one?
Right. So you have already all the orientation information here. Okay. So you have this map, etc. So now you can compare, for example, if you compare this key equals 0 to the key equals 1, you can already deal with the orientation with 15 degrees, for example. You see what I mean? So currently in your comparison, in your similar geometric verification, you are comparing key 0 to the key 0, equals 0.
This one? Not this one. Okay. This one?
I guess Zhenyu's question is basically,
you don't need to reconstruct all of
that. The original image can be rotated k times.
Mm-hmm.
Current image can be rotated k times.
He has already done that. He has already done that.
You have this k map, and supposedly you can map with the destination, the query, the retrieval image, each time.
You need to find all the
possibilities.
That would be expensive.
Because, okay, I guess, no. If you rotate, there are two rotations here. One is another rotation. One is each quadrant will divide it into R parts. You're going to construct for each part. Okay, that's one rotation. Another rotation is an image rotated. How do you construct this spatial coding map for the rotated image?
Okay, so my question is, here you compare key, right? Key equals key, it's the same key.
Because key is, in your case, is only like a 3. k is from 1 to 3, r is 3. So it's just 4. Just 0, 2, 3. Just 0, 3 is...
k is different from the orientation
key? Yeah. Yes, it's different.
Yeah, this is That we deal with rotation invariance, the same idea.
Yeah, I sort of got you. So we construct the last one is slides. This is the slides for the this one. This is one. I didn't talk about all of them, but say SC. This is spatial coding. SC 30 means you pre-rotate 30 different angles. Okay, so that's the performance. When you rotate more, you got better performance. And this is a geometric coding, okay, using a square and the one I haven't talked about it. So we found later we developed this called the geometric coding. Its time cost is smaller, okay. It's similar to when they rotate any 8 times, but performance it's close to 30, okay. So basically, again, a trade-off between time. And so if you rotate spatial coding, you can rotate more angles okay, to get better performance. But again, it's time cost.
Okay.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.